This is Why We Stand on Westchester Talk Radio. I'm your host, Joe Archino, and we are broadcasting live from Trinity Fitness and Nutrition in Rye, New York. Once again, a very big thank you to Mike Duty, Intellectual Combat. He's a big part of this program for letting us be here and doing the show. We are, of course, produced by Sharp Creative and made possible by Entergy, Indian Point Energy Center, Hightower Westchester, White Plains Hospital, Westchester County Office of Economic Development, Robeson, and Accorda Therapeutics. It is always an honor when we can bring on Ken Kraetzer. He is the best in the business when it comes to covering Army football. Ken actually invited me to come and cover Army-Navy Media Day with him down at Lincoln Financial Field, which was an absolute blast. Ken, thank you for being on the program. Army football, that's what you're here to talk about. You cover better than anybody else.
There's some good people I know who cover Army football.
There is, Ken, but you talk about consistency and output of media production. You cover that team as well as anybody in the business. But, Ken, it really was a historic season for Army. 11 wins, a incredible bowl win, 70-14 over Houston. You were there for all of it. What was it like to cover this historic team?
Well, it's amazing. I mean, yeah, the bowl game was something else. They pounded Houston. A lot of veterans tribute to that game, the Armed Forces Bowl, sponsored by Lockheed Martin. They did a great job honoring veterans throughout the whole day and the day before. But it was a year that was building. It was the third big year in a row for Army that they won a bowl game. Not too many NCAA teams have won three bowl games in a row.
No, actually not.
And they built up to win the Commander-in-Chief Trophy for the second year. They defeated Air Force in a close game at home, and then they defeated Navy in a close game where Navy was making a big push in the fourth quarter, and Army had to make big defensive plays to hold on to that game. But they did it, and that was kind of one of the earmarks of this Army team, is they learned to make the big plays when they needed it against Miami in the overtime. Miami scores, and they're going to go for two. They're either going to win the game or lose the game on that play, on the two-point conversion. And the play was that the quarterback was going to try and pass, but he was getting tackled, getting sacked, and he dumped the ball over to a halfback who ran the other side of the field and was gone over the five-yard line. One guy from Army grabs him, but wouldn't hold onto him, but Elijah Riley came from the other side of the field full speed to make the play at the two-yard line, made the tackle, stopped the two-point conversion, and Army won that game in overtime. And that was just the way the season went. One of the moments that stands out for me was out at Oklahoma, and that was a special trip. We got out to Fort Sill the day before, saw the field artillery training area, and then we were at Oklahoma. 87,000 people at the stadium there, very modern, rebuilt stadium, and and the Oklahoma people couldn't believe that Army was running these long drives. They had one 19-play run for a touchdown. I don't think they passed more than once in that game. And the Heisman Trophy winner, Kyler Murray, standing on the sideline the whole day. He'd get in the game, and he'd score in four plays, and then he'd sit on the bench again for a half an hour because they couldn't get Army's offense off the field. Army kept running the dive play, running the pitch play, and the Oklahoma defense just did not know what to do to stop the third down plays. Army was running. Whenever it was fourth and one, they would go for it, and they would always make it with Darnell Wolfolk, the fullback. But, the way it works for us is we usually are in the press box for most of the game, but then the last 5 minutes we run down the stairs, whatever the fastest way is to get to the field in a timeout. And I'm standing, I go out the tunnel, we're in the end zone. Army's got the ball, it's 21-all with 2 minutes to play. And they're getting down to a 3rd-and-14 play at the Oklahoma, about 25-yard line. And later the coach said he needed 5 or 6 yards to have a good field goal chance, so he's trying to do that. So there's a timeout, and then Oklahoma calls there's a TV timeout, and Oklahoma calls a timeout. And the linebacker for Oklahoma puts his hands up, and he's yelling, he's waving for the crowd to make noise. 87,000 people screaming for the Oklahoma defense, because if they don't make this play, they're going to lose the game to Army. They never lose at home, much less Army. They made the noise that they make when Nebraska comes in. And that was one of the biggest time moments I've ever seen in my years covering sports. On that play, Oklahoma happened to make a very good defensive play. One guy got the quarterback, hit his arm. The pass was deflected, and it got intercepted. And then they went down the field. They missed a field goal. When they could have won, it was a fairly short field goal, and then they won it in overtime. Kyler Murray showed why he's Heisman Trophy quarterback. But it's just moments like that. And then winning the Commander Chief Trophy for the second year in a row is just such a big deal at West Point. You know, when you go up there and even up there, everything up there at West Point says beat Navy. It's on the roofs. It's on every wall. It's all over the athletic facilities, all the T-shirts. They all talk about singing second, which is what you do if you win the Navy, one of the Service Academy games, and they sang second for the third, for the second year in a row, and it was just amazing. Third year in a row, excuse me. So it's been, under Jeff Munkin, just a resurgence of Army football. It's hard to describe the intensity he brings to Army. He could coach the Jets. I thought, when I heard about some of the problems the Jets were having, I said Jeff Munkin would fix that instantly. You know, as far as motivation, lighting a spark under anybody who's not given 100%. And then he's a PhD in football and organizational. He knows how to keep everybody. A college football team, you got over 100 players. You got 30 or so staff and assistants, and he keeps everybody going in the same direction.
I really enjoyed, during when we covered Army-Navy Media Day, his talk. He's so well-spoken. You could just see he's built for this job. He's built to be Army's guy. And there was a lot of talk in the offseason. Would he take a bigger job? What would happen? But you cover the team, Bert. You've talked to him many times. Do you look at him as kind of just being the typical, this is the perfect spot for him?
Well, I think he's really embraced it in terms of understanding the Army football team represents the United States Army. It represents all the soldiers serving around the world and the excitement and pride that it brings to them. I got to tell you a quick Jeff Munkin story. After the Navy game, and we're in the post game, we ask him all the questions and so on. I asked one more question. I say, Coach, did you say hello to the president? Because the president did the coin toss at the game. And then he crosses the sideline at halftime as a tradition of the Army-Navy game. And then I said, did you say hello to General Milley, who was his promotion to chairman of the Joint Chiefs, was announced at halftime. That's what happens at the Army-Navy game. And so he starts to answer the question. He says, yeah, the president was gracious enough to come over and shake my hand and before the game. And it was so great to meet him at the White House in the spring. And then he stops and he says, it's 30 seconds to kickoff. I'm talking to my guys on the headset about the plays, what we're going to do. I'm trying to get the kickoff team out on the field. And the leader of the free world comes up and says, and wants to wish me luck and shake my hand. And he just stopped and he said, that was so special. And, how much it means to his family and how much it means to everybody at the academy. And it was nice to hear him be so genuine that he said, about General Milley, because I got a photo of them on the podium together with the trophy. And the Commander-in-Chief Trophy, and he says, General Milley, what a dedicated soldier he is, and what a great opportunity this is for him to serve in another leadership role. So it was just one of those neat moments, and from interviewing, sometimes you take a chance on a question, but you're thinking about it, and he embraced it. And he and I have we've done so many interviews that I've kind of figured out the kind of things he likes to talk about.
That's true, and, it's like you said, you come up with those opportunities sometimes, you get gold, and that was a great, great story. Ken, where does Army go from here? They've had so much success the last few seasons. There's so much to be excited about. What do you think we're going to see from Army next season?
They want more of the same, I'll tell you that. They want to continue to win the Commander-in-Chief Trophy, which is their number one goal, and beating Navy. Army's won the last 3 years, but Navy won 14 years in a row, so I think Army wants to beat that record, but we'll see. I mean, the Navy guys, you met them at the media day, they're great guys. The coach, Kenny Manalolo, is a great guy.
Some people might not know, him and then Jeff Malkin are actually very close friends. They've coached together before they were both at their respective positions. They're really close.
Oh, yeah, it's great respect. They coached at, the lowest level assistant coaches at the University of Hawaii 30 years ago. And then they coached on the same staff at Navy for 7-8 years. It's a very respectful rivalry between the two. Don't ask him about Air Force, though.
No, I think that's from being around for a little while, you could tell that for sure.
That's a little different.
I do want to shout out, though, some of where you could find some of Ken's great work. You go on his Facebook page, which has done some really great numbers. People have really enjoyed the videos and all the other information Ken puts out there, Sons of the American Legion Radio, and then your YouTube channel, Ken. Ken Kraetzer, over 1,000 subscribers now. One of the things that, that you know, I really respect from being able to work with you is how you're always moving from one place to another. There's always so many different things to cover and to get to and people to talk to. What have you learned? How have you adapted over the last few seasons, especially with Army success? You definitely want to make sure you're capturing everything that you have to.
Well, you know, I learned something I from meeting the former mayor of Boston, Ray Flynn, a veteran, a great basketball player, and then the ambassador to the Vatican at one point. And he, and in his book, he writes about when he covered, when he was ambassador to the Vatican, he made sure he went to the Pope's, every single one of his audiences. Anytime the Pope made a public appearance, he made sure that he was there. In fact, got to the point, the Pope, if you couldn't make one, the Pope would say, where's Ray today? And that's what you have to do covering a team, and I'm very fortunate. We try to get to practice at least once a week, and we're on, we're in the post games, and before game, we try to go out and cover a lot of the events. The West Point Band usually has a concert before most of the other games that they did down in Fort Worth. And then we cover the pregame show, the national anthem, before the network goes on the air, and things like that. And then it's just, you know, the players, we always say that we earn the right to be in the post game at the Army-Navy game because we're there at August practice. And I was out of practice on a Sunday night one night when it just happened to work out on schedules. And the coaches and the players see that. And you build a relationship. I mean, we try to meet anybody who starts playing, like when they're a freshman or a sophomore, and we try to interview everybody at least once a year. And then the guys who become captains, we talk to very often, Cole Christensen this year, and Darnell Wolfolk, captain, and then the incredible Bryce Holland, the center. I mean, we voted him for the Remington Award. We actually have a vote in that now. And he should have got more national attention, a three-year starter. And it was nice that Sports Illustrated voted the Army offensive line for their all-bowl team this year. They singled out players across who had stood out in the bowl season. They said, you know, any offensive line that could generate 507 yards of rushing offense and get the opposing coach fired is, she could be worse.
I would agree with that.
I feel
that.
Bad for Major Applewhite. He's a nice guy. He talked to us a couple of times, and sorry that that happened, but I'm sure he's going to have another great position.
Absolutely. I mean, that's 70-14 win, though. It's still, you know, I think as we wind down, surely there's so many moments from the season that stick out to you. But from you going down to Oklahoma or being on the field to cover the Navy win or the bowl win, is there one moment for you that continues to stick out more than any other?
Well, the 87,000 people yelling for their defense to try to make a play to beat Army, I will never forget.
That was when you told that very well.
And, you know, moments, and then the tackle by Elijah Riley in the Miami game. Everything about the Navy game is special. And then just watching Army play so well against a good Houston team, that run that the quarterback had, Kelvin Hopkins, to score Army's second touchdown. I mean, literally runs left, runs right, runs left, runs right. All of a sudden, he's got four linemen surrounding him, and he goes 76 yards for a touchdown. And what I'm fortunate to know is these are great people on the team. They all study very hard. Most of them have engineering majors. And they all go through basic training, and they have military duties. They're up at 5:30 in the morning. And in the summertime, they go and they do Army duty for 3-4 weeks at the start. Then they take classes, and then they start practice August 1st. It really is a grind for them, but they handle it well. They never complain. They embrace it. And they are going to be all great future leaders of the United States Army, and then what they go on to be after that.
Ken, this is always a pleasure to talk to you. Really enjoyed it. It was a historic season for Army football. This guy was there for every part of it, covering it, and it is always a pleasure to be able to bring him on this program. Ken, thank you for giving us some time today, and looking forward to having you on again in the future.
Absolutely, Joe. It's always a pleasure. You're doing a great job. I really enjoyed listening to the veterans you had in the early segments today, the gentleman who has served in three different branches of the military and as a medic is really special. That's a tremendous career that he's had, and is now he's working, continues to serve, as they say, with his tennis program for veterans.
It's incredible. We are so lucky. Mike Duty, Isaac Cortez, have so many great people on this program. Don't go anywhere. We will be back soon. Everyone, you're listening to Westchester Talk Radio. We are broadcasting live, of course, from Trinity Fitness and Nutrition, Rye, New York. Don't go anywhere. We will be right back.